There's a difference, though, like, between what you just said mm-hmm. and what some monks would teach from, like, the Middle Ages, like Brother Lawrence and practicing the presence of God. So my question to you is, what is the difference between practicing the presence of Jesus and mindfulness?
Okay, so I don't believe that you need to practice the presence of God. I think the presence of God is inside of us, okay? And I think that when you surrender on a daily basis to the presence of God within, and that presence is consciousness, it's mind, it's intent, it's purpose, it's all those things, it's light, it's presence. But when you're surrendering on a daily basis to that light, you, the real you, becomes more of that light. So the false you, the I, the ego, the one that Jesus tells us to die, okay, starts to dissolve. So you see less of being fake or less of being fear, less of, you know, all the other ungodly attributes, and all the other godly attributes inside of you awaken, grow, and that's the presence of God. So I don't think it's something that I need to practice. I need to surrender to the presence of God within me in order for that light to expand. And then people feel that. People feel the presence of God then. They feel, look, that person's, I feel his warmth, I feel his care, I feel his compassion, I feel his electricity, I feel his love, I feel his presence. But all they're really saying is that I feel his light. So I don't, it's not something I need to practice though. It's something that I need to become.
But isn't what, but that you'd say, a Buddhist would say, well, okay, it's always about practice. So what's wrong for a Christian to say this is practicing the presence of God?
I don't think the word practice really describes what it is, because, you know, if you look at the word practice, you normally use that word when doing something that requires discipline, okay? And there's nothing wrong with having discipline or doing something over and over again to acquire something, but the truth of the matter is it's not really a practice. It's something that's within us that just needs to grow. It's like when Jesus said, you know, we all have a measure of faith. It's like a seed that grows. The presence of God in us grows as we yield to it, not as we practice the presence of God. It's not something external. Whereas the word practice is something that points to something outside of ourselves.
But that's where we go. Because when I'm saying I'm practicing the presence of Jesus, when you take away the practice idea, you're experiencing the presence of Jesus. I think it's the presence of Jesus, whereas somebody else doing mindfulness is experiencing something of their own nature. But what about practicing the presence of, what about the mindfulness on Jesus? Doesn't Jesus, as a separate person within, happen?
Right, okay, so let me give you an example of mindfulness in the way that I understand it. Right, let's just say, for example, I need to make a choice. And this choice requires me making a decision about a specific person where I might need to give that person an investment. Okay? And on the outside, I look at that person's character, and he's perfect. He has all the right attributes, he's trustworthy, etc., good references. But on the inside of me, I don't feel comfortable. So I'm mindful of a feeling, of a knowing, of a warning that's telling me no. And I yield to that. And lo and behold, in a month's or 2 months' time, it's revealed that I made the right decision. Or I don't yield to that, and then the investment is bad. It's just a little example, okay? So it's not a practice, it's more being awake to the wisdom of God that's in us, to the love of God that's in us, to the forgiveness of God that's in us. When God asks us to forgive those who hate us, or pray for those who persecute us, we can do it in a formulaic way. We can say, right, the scriptures say, so therefore I do, right? And that's very much following the law. Or we can go deep within ourselves and go, why should I forgive this person? Can I find, God, can you help me forgive this person? And then it's an internal act of devotion. And that's when the life of God within us awakens. And if we surrender to it, the presence of God is then manifest. Does that make sense, Roy?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So it's not like the practice denotes of something outside. I am practicing the Christ nature. I am doing exactly what Jesus wants me to do. But what if really I'm just doing it like a command? For example, we find this in the text. The story of the two sons. One goes away, squanders all his livelihood, but people forget the other son. Do you remember what the other son said? He said, look, Father, I have been doing everything that you've required of me. I've been doing all the very things that you've wanted him to do, and yet you're giving him a feast. And that's my point. He was practicing the very things that he wanted his father to do. Not from the inside, because he couldn't see his father's heart. He couldn't see his father's love. He couldn't enter into that mercy, that love relationship. So what did he do? He practiced what his father wanted him to do. And that only takes you so far. You become a law-abiding citizen. But it doesn't mean that you carry the presence of God.
Okay, that's cool.
There's a good example of it.
But what about things where people would, like Brother Lawrence, where he would practice the presence of Jesus,
mm-hmm.
washing dishes, and then people would come from miles around just to experience him washing dishes because something came off of him that was not himself, that was something of God.
But I believe Brother Lawrence was, when he was washing dishes, he was in Christ. He was in that presence. He was surrendering to that presence on a daily basis. I think that it's not that he was washing the dishes, it's that he was being obedient. And so he was in the moment. He was in the presence. He was in that state, what people call it, the Christ state. But I just say that he was following the light of God within him. There's no different than the Magi's that found Christ. They were following the light of God, the sense of awareness. They were mindful of all the signs and wonders, and they found Christ. And yet Herod and his scholars, who had the word of God, knew where he was going to be born, didn't turn up.
All right. What are some of the things that you do then to experience it on a greater level?
Okay.
Because you've taught me stuff. I mean,
yeah.
What are things that people can do to get better at being mindful?
Okay, the first thing that people have to recognize, and this is going to go against complete Christian theology, okay? I do not believe in the way that the Protestant, especially the Protestant Reformation and the Catholic Church teach that the human condition, okay? So for example, like, if you accept that you are lost, Jesus says that the story of the lost coin or the lost son or the lost sheep clearly points out that humans are lost within themselves. And if you can accept that, then you can kind of come back home. But it's very hard to say, but on the other hand, it's very hard for humans to accept that they are sinners. Right? And what I mean by sinners is that very hard-hitting, condemning word that suggests that they're carrying the burden of sin, they've made huge mistakes, that there is a way home, they've got to believe, and that's the only way home. I go against that. I think that Jesus was saying, look, within the nature of humanity, within the real nature of humanity is that we all want to be loved and love. Yeah? And when we are disconnected to who God is, we don't feel that love. And that's what lost is, being disconnected. Okay? So I think if humans can accept that they feel disconnected, they can also accept that, that one day they can be reconnected. And being reconnected is accepting that they are disconnected. And just that point there, if they can be mindful of that disconnection and then go, look, how can I reconnect back? You'll start to feel the presence of God within you awaken. That light, that spark, that seed of faith that Christ speaks, talks about, will start to awaken. It will start to ignite just by that simple acceptance. Hey, look, I'm disconnected. And when I'm disconnected, I do feel barren and lost and, you know, and bound and confused and heavy. So that's the first phase. That's the first phase. You might want to use the word sin and repentance. I'm trying to describe it in the way that Christ would really describe it, you know?
Yeah, yeah. So what's the next?
Right. So then the next step is who am I? What is my nature? What is my true nature? Right. Now, the story of the lost coin. Jesus talks about a certain woman who's looking for a coin. And she sweeps the house, she looks for it, she gathers around and she finds it, she looks at the coin. I found it. And then she tells her friends. Well, what do you find on a coin? You find an image. A likeness, an image. So the next phase is to ask, who am I? What is my likeness? Who am I like? And that's where Christ comes in. If you really want to know what you're like, you are like God. We are created in His image and in His likeness. And so, and then the next question is, how do I find that? He came 2,000 years ago to answer that question. He said, so look, the nature of Christ manifest on the earth reveals what we're like. And when we're not manifesting that nature and that presence, we just need to go back to Christ and say, look, you know, I've messed up again. It's okay. You'll come back to it. You'll soon realize who you are.